Hello friends, I welcome you to my channel. Today, let us study Unit 3 of Mechanics of Machines of 3rd SEM. Mechanics of Machines of 3rd SEM, the third unit in that subject is Friction. So today we are going to take up Friction. In this, you will get about two questions. Around 30 marks, two questions. You will get two problems also, about 15 marks. Theory, 15 marks, problem will be there. Now, what is friction? Let us see what is friction. Whenever two bodies in contact have or tend to have relative motion between them, then such relative motion experiences an opposition, a natural opposition, a opposition which is natural. Now this, the force which is responsible for this opposition is known as the force of friction, or simply it is called as friction. So friction is nothing but a natural force which is experienced whenever there is a relative motion or tendency of relative motion between two bodies in contact with each other. So that is friction. Now why this friction takes place? Why this opposition takes place? See, whenever two bodies are in contact with each other and they have to have relative motion, we try to finish them as smoothly as possible. But even then, if you study it under a powerful microscope, you will find there are many ups and downs there. So these ups and downs in both the surfaces get interlocked, and as a result of that, there will be friction. This friction is occurs. Now, this friction is useful in some places and it is not useful at some other places. Now, it is harmful. It is useful in some places. It is harmful in some other places. Now, if there is no friction between our feet and the earth, we cannot walk on it. We start slipping. If there is no friction between the tire and the tire of a vehicle or and the road, then the tire will not roll over the earth. So, it will start slipping. So, like this, in some places, friction is wanted, desirable, required. Like in a brake, in a clutch, for example, friction is desirable. In some places, it is harmful or it is undesirable. For example, in a bearing, it is undesirable because we lose some power due to friction between the bearing and the shaft. Now, because it is undesirable, we cannot throw it out. We cannot completely remove it. We cannot say you get out. It's not possible. What we can do is we can try to reduce it to the extent possible, practically possible. When it is desirable, we cannot increase it beyond certain point. What we can do is we can increase it to the extent possible, not beyond that. So friction in some places in engineering, it is both desirable as well as undesirable. Now here in friction, first you have to know what is friction. What is the meaning of limiting force of friction? Limiting force of friction means the maximum force of friction which comes into play between a given pair of surfaces. That is called as the limiting force of friction. That means, suppose I have a rough surface here. I have placed a body here. Let us say we have placed a body here. This is a body resting on it. Now, this body has weight W. It has a normal reaction which is perpendicular to the contact surface. The contact surface is here. Now, I try to push this with a small force. With a very small force, I try to push it. Now, it doesn't move forward. Let us say it doesn't move forward when I apply that force. That means a natural force is acting on the body, which is equal in magnitude to this force and opposite in direction, which is preventing it from the body to move. Now, in the direction of the applied force. This is the force of friction. Right. Now, what I do, I try to increase it very slowly, very slowly, very gradually I try to increase it. As I increase this, what happens is this also increases simultaneously up to a point beyond which it cannot further increase. When that point is reached, what happens is the body will just begin to slide. Now, when that happens, the magnitude of this force will be exactly equal to this. This force is called as the limiting force of friction or the maximum force of friction. Right. Maximum force of friction, which comes into play between the surface, these two surfaces which are in contact with each other. So, this is called as the limiting force of friction. Now, this limiting force of friction bears a constant ratio with the normal reaction. F by Rn is constant. For a given pair of bodies, for a given pair of surfaces, the ratio F, limiting force of friction to normal reaction, is a constant. This constant is denoted by mu. It is denoted by mu, and this mu is known as the coefficient of friction. This is called as the coefficient of friction. Right. So, the coefficient of friction is defined as the ratio of limiting force of friction to the normal reaction between a given pair of contact surfaces is known as coefficient of friction. It is denoted by mu. It has no unit. You must know this. You must know what is meant by limiting force of friction, what is coefficient of friction, and the angle of friction. What is angle of friction? Angle of friction means, suppose we have an inclined plane. I have an inclined plane here. So, this is a rough inclined plane. On this, a body is resting on this. This is a body. This is its weight. This is normal reaction, let us say. Now, this angle, let me call this as theta. Now, this body has a tendency to move downwards, but it is not moving. Why it is not moving? Because there is a friction, a force of friction, which is opposing its motion in this direction. Now, what I do is, this angle of inclination is gradually increased. If I very gradually increase it, what happens is, when I reach a particular value, this angle reaches a particular value, this body will just begin to slide downwards. The angle of this plane at that particular point is known as the angle of friction. It is denoted by phi. Angle of friction is denoted by phi, and this mu is also equal to tan of phi. Tan phi, the angle for an inclined plane, the coefficient of friction can be given as tan of phi, that where phi is called the angle of friction. Angle of friction means it is the angle at which the body just begins to slide of the inclined plane, when it just begins to slide, that is called as the angle of friction. So, tan of angle of friction is given as the coefficient of friction. That way also it can be given. So, these definitions you are supposed to know. Then, we have to come to study of bearings and clutches. Bearings and clutches. Because friction occurs here in bearings and clutches. Because there will be relative motion here, friction occurs, and we have to study that. So, first we will take up friction in bearings. Now, what is a bearing? Bearing is defined as a static or stationary machine element which supports a moving element or the shaft. Generally, the moving element is called as the shaft. This shaft rotates. This is the bearing. It offers support to it. It's a stationary machine element which supports a moving element or a shaft. That is the definition of a bearing. So, in a bearing, there is always relative motion because one fixed part is there and the other one is a moving part. So, there is relative motion. So, whenever there is a relative motion, there is friction. So, this friction in a bearing is undesirable because it causes loss of power. So, therefore, what we do is we try to reduce friction to the extent possible by lubricating the bearing. By applying the lubricant between the parts, we try to reduce it to the extent possible. Now, in bearings, there are two types. They are first classified into two types. One are called the sliding contact bearings. Sliding contact bearings. Here, the contact is one element slides over the other. The other one is the rolling contact bearings. Rolling contact bearings. Here, the one element rolls over another element. These are also called as anti-friction bearings because in this, the friction comparatively compared to this, in that the friction is lesser. So, they are also called as rolling contact bearings, are also called as anti-friction bearings. These are further classified into right line or guide bearing, then journal bearings and thrust bearings. Similarly, these are also classified into three types. One is ball bearings, roller bearings, and needle bearings. They are also classified into three. Now, right line or guide bearing, we don't have any mathematical treatment on this. Just you should know. Now, you see, you have seen a shaper. Ram of a shaper, it moves over a surface that guides. So, that surface is a right line or guide bearing. Here, parallel to that, the relative motion takes place parallel to the support. Now, journal bearing, in a journal bearing, it is like this. This is the moving element. This is the shaft. This is the bearing. The shaft rotates like this. This is the axis of the shaft. The load acts like this. So, the load on the bearing is perpendicular to the axis of the moving element, then it is called as the journal bearing. In a thrust bearing, it is like this. This is the axis of the shaft. The shaft rotates like this. It is supported here. Then it is called as a thrust bearing. The load is axial, or it is parallel to the axis of the shaft. Here it is, the load is perpendicular to the axis of the moving element. Here it is parallel to it. Now, this is the difference between, here W is perpendicular to the axis of the shaft. Here it is parallel to the axis of the shaft. So, that is called as a thrust bearing. Generally, you get a problem on thrust bearings, where the problem will be, The problem asked is, what is the power lost due to friction? This, we don't have any problems in this. We don't get any problem. Only theory can be asked. This only the only thing that will be asked is on thrust bearing, usually. What they ask is the power lost due to friction. The power lost due to friction is given by the general formula 2 pi nt by 60. It is given in kilowatts. Here, N stands for speed of the rotating element or moving element, speed in RPM. This will be directly given. And T is the torque lost or absorbed due to friction. Torque lost in friction in kilonewton meter. Kilonewton meters. If you substitute T in kilonewton meters, you get the power lost in kilowatts. So this is T. So this, to get power, we should know torque. Now this torque, for different bearings, it will be, you will have different formula under different conditions. This we have to study now. Now, this is a general formula for power, but for torque, we use different formulae. Now, this for general bearing, T will be equal to mu W R. Mu W R, this is the formula for torque. Mu is coefficient of friction, R is the radius, that is half of the diameter, W is the load. This W will be equal to PB into L into D. L is length of the bearing, D is dia of the bearing, PB is bearing pressure, permissible bearing pressure in kilonewton meters. Kilonewton per square meter. These two in meters will give you this in kilonewton. Mu has no unit. W in kilonewtons, R in meters will give you this in kilonewton meters. Torque will be given in kilonewton meters. Generally, no problem will be asked in journal bearing. They don't ask it. Here, the bearing area will be like this. It will be a rectangle. This is length of the bearing. This is dia of the bearing or dia of the shaft. So this is called the bearing area. The bearing area will be L into D. The bearing pressure into bearing area will give you the load, for calculating the load. So that's it. Now, generally the problem comes in thrust bearings. The thrust bearings are further classified into two types. One are called the pivot bearings and the other is called collar bearings. Now, the principal difference between these two is, in a pivot bearing, the shaft ends in the bearing, it doesn't extend beyond the bearing. In a collar bearing, the shaft extends beyond the bearing, then it is called as collar bearing. Now, in pivot bearing, again, there are different types. One is flat pivot bearing, that is, this one is a flat pivot bearing. It is also called as footstep bearing. Flat pivot bearing is also called as this thing. The other one is conical pivot bearing. Conical pivot bearing. Now, conical pivot bearing means it can be like this. It can be like this. It may be full conical pivot. Like this. It can be full conical pivot. Or it may be truncated conical pivot. That means it will be like this. Now, if it is like this, the bearing area will be like this. The supporting area will be like this. Here, this is the inner diameter and this is the outer diameter. If you get two diameters, if they are given two diameters, one as outer or external diameter and the other one as internal diameter, then it is this bearing. If there is only one diameter, then it is full conical pivot bearing. If it is full conical pivot bearing, it will be like this. Like this, the bearing area will be full circle. So only one diameter will be there, that is the dia of the shaft. Whatever is the dia of the shaft, only that will be there. If it is truncated, there will be one outer, one inner diameter. In collar bearing, you get only flat collar bearing. There is also conical collar, but you get only flat collar bearing. This will be the shaft. This is a collar. the shaft can extend beyond this. Now there will be support will be here, so the contact surface will be like this. This is the dia of the shaft, that is inner dia of the contact surface. This is the outer dia of the bearing, that is collar dia will be the outer dia, shaft dia will be the inner dia. The load will be acting like this. Now in a collar bearing, you can have single collar or multi collar, single or multi collar bearings. That means if the load is too great, too much, then the size of the collar needs to be very large. So to avoid that, we can have a number of collars like this of same size, same diameter collars. You can have any number of them. So like this, they can be supported at different places like this. So this is called as a multi-collar bearing. Either you can have a single collar bearing or a multi-collar bearing. So on one of these bearings, usually thrust bearings, you get a problem for 6, 7, 8 marks. 6 to 8 marks, one problem will be there. And generally, what they will ask is, either they ask the power loss due to friction, or if they are given the power loss due to friction, they may ask some other quantity like diameter or the diameters or the coefficient of friction. Anything can be asked like that. So these are the problems which have to be solved in bearings. We will take up a few problems from your question bank. I am going to take up a few problems and try to solve them. So now, in case of flat pivot bearing, or it is also called as footstep bearing, I have given this sketch. This sketch will be like this. This is the shaft, this is the load, this is diameter of the shaft, the support is here, and this is the this thing. Now here you will get two formulae. One, assuming that the pressure throughout the surface is uniform, at every place the pressure is same, if you assume, then W will be equal to PB, that is permissible bearing pressure, into pi r square, so many kilonewton. Pi r square is the area, bearing area, into bearing pressure. PB is the permissible bearing pressure in kilonewton per square meter or kilopascal. It can also be called as kilopascal. R is the radius of shaft or bearing in meters. This will be d by 2. If they have given the diameter, then it will be d by 2. This will give you W in kilonewtons, and then T will be equal to torque lost due to friction will be equal to 2/3 mu WR, so many kilonewton meters. That is, mu is coefficient of friction, W is load, I have told you how to calculate load on the bearing in kilonewtons, and R is again radius of the shaft or bearing in meter. So this will give you the torque. Then power can be calculated using the formula 2πNT/60. So this is the formula. If we assume uniform wear, generally we don't assume uniform wear in bearings because friction is undesirable, so we don't do, but if they ask, you will have to do it. Assuming uniform wear, generally it will not be asked, But if it is asked, you have to do it. W will be same, Pb into pi r square. Same formula, so many kilonewton. But T will be half mu W r. Mu W r, kilonewton meters. If it is assuming uniform wear, for flat pivot bearing or footstep bearing only, these are the formulae. Generally in bearings, we assume uniform pressure. They will ask you to assume uniform pressure because in bearing friction is undesirable. In clutch, they ask you to assume uniform wear because their friction is desirable. Next, conical pivot bearing, second one, conical pivot bearing that is full, that means only one diameter is given, that means this figure will get modified like this. Here this will not be flat, it will be like this. So this is the contact surface, this is D, dia of the shaft, same will be the dia of the circle. This angle is called, from here to here, it is called 2 alpha. So alpha will be semi-cone angle. Full cone angle is semi-cone angle in degrees. Now, assuming uniform pressure, you get W is Pb into pi r square. The notations are same, no change, kilonewton. T will be equal to 2/3 mu W r divided by sine alpha. So many kilonewton meters, where alpha is semi-cone angle, that is this angle is alpha. Okay, same thing here, assuming uniform wear, W will be Pb into pi r square only, T will be half mu W r divided by sine alpha. That's the difference. Next, third one, if it is conical pivot bearing, truncated. So here, it is cut like this, no contact here, contact is only here, so you get one more this thing, this is capital D, so this will be capital R, half of that will be capital R, this will be small r, the contact is here, there is no contact at the center, contact is only there, so one is small r and the other one is capital R. Now, this is third one, conical pivot bearing, it is truncated, you get two radii here, whenever two diameters or two radii are given, it is this. So now, assuming uniform pressure, W will be equal to, load will be equal to Pb into pi, now the radius r square minus r square, because there is no contact there, so many kilonewtons, and T will be equal to 2/3 mu W divided by sine alpha into r cube minus r cube divided by r square minus r square. So many no sine alpha here, it is, yes, sine alpha is there. So many kilonewton meters, assuming uniform pressure. If you assume uniform wear, W will be 2 pi P b into small r into r capital R minus small r, so many kilonewtons, and T will be half mu w by sine alpha into r plus r, so many kilonewton meters. These are the formulae. So in pivot, either it will be flat or full cone or truncated conical pivot. I have given all the formulae that come here. Next, we have to go to collar bearings. In thrust bearings, there are two. One is pivot and the other is collar. We'll have to go to collar bearing next. So for fourth one is flat collar bearing. If it is a flat collar bearing, what will be the formula for this thing? Flat collar bearing, it will be like this. This is the shaft, this is the collar. The shaft extends beyond the collar. So the bearing is here. Now the contact surface will be like this between these two. This is small r, this is capital R, this is small capital D, and this is dia of shaft small d. Now assuming uniform pressure, pressure W, same formula, PB into pi into R square minus R square, so many kilonewton. T will be 2 by 3 mu W into R cube minus small r cube divided by capital R square minus small r square, so many kilonewton meters. Here it will be W will be same. This will be half mu W into R plus R into R plus R. No sine alpha will be there. In case it is multi-collar bearing, in case of, here there is a note, in case of multi-collar bearing, ring W will be PB into pi into R square minus R square, this W into N, so many kilonewtons, assuming uniform pressure. R W will be 2 pi PB R into R minus R into N, so many kilonewton, assuming uniform, where N is number of collars. Usually if it is a multi-collar bearing, they will ask us to find out the number of collars. So these are the formulae. After finding the torque using these formulae, for all bearings, the common formula is P is equal to 2 pi NT by 60. That's it. Thank you.